First of all, it's fantastic to be here. The weather is great for those who are outside. We are outside, but maybe we can be outside later. And I think a quick look at the town yesterday, and I think it's great. And hopefully I will explore it more tonight with you. And I want to talk about agile innovation and why people matters. I will try to put the people perspective on agile and why we must care about that we actually have people in our organizations. But first of all, I will start with another topic. This is actually a real thing taking place in Sweden at a company. There was an email sent at 2 a.m. on a Friday night to a product manager who hosted a team project. And a team member had solved the solution for a major problem they had worked on for many, many, many weeks. And he found a solution, and he emailed it in the middle of the night and went to bed. And the product manager picked it up on Monday because he was at home with his kids or something, doing something else than reading the email. So he picked it up in the Monday morning, and he was hilarious. Oh, finally the solution, we can move forward. And he told the stakeholder, and at the next status report he wrote, he told them, oh, this is great, we have solved the problem. And I want to think about what was the first question he got from the stakeholder when he reported that they have solved the problem. But let's go back to innovation. And I would think I will talk about innovation, and I don't want to talk about how this is assembled and what fabrics are we using. I want to talk about what is an innovation and who creates an innovation. And for me, it is people who create innovations. We are real people with great ideas, bad ideas, a lot of ideas, and some of these ideas will be innovations. And they are good and they are bad, and they will be rejected and they will be accepted in a faster and faster pace. But it is people who actually create the innovations. And it is not robots who actually create them. Because a robot is very good at a thing we have taught it, or implemented a shift. You should move this box here, and you should drive this truck here, you should do this, you should go from A to B. But the robot will never think about another way to solve it. Okay, if I go here, and I go here, man, wait, I can go here, maybe. No, the robot will never do that. So, I hear a lot about people being replaced by robots. And I will say this, if we replace all the people in our organizations with robots, we will kill innovation. Maybe we have some smart robots with great HR or something in the future, but then it's another story. But today, we will not have it. We will kill innovation. We will do the same thing all over again. And we will do something completely different. Gallup made a survey in 2013, when they asked the employee, a lot of 230,000 employees, how engaged are you at work? And I picked up this report, and I thought about myself, okay, I looked around, I said, okay, it's engaged, she's engaged, he's not very engaged. And I thought about, okay, 50% maybe could be engaged at work. But then again, the number were extremely low. The highest number was actually Denmark, 23%, I think. You got 13%. Sweden got 16%. So we are not much better. And that's quite sad. 13% of the people going to work are engaged. It's like we take all the people in this room, we have like the first row, you're engaged. The rest of you, you're waiting for next break. Lunch, when is lunch? And when we have a backseat, you don't even want to be here. You want to be at home. And we're talking about how can we create innovations faster, and more innovations. Well, start with engaging your personnel, your people in your organizations. Because if you don't have engagement, you will never have innovations. Because innovations is created by people that is actually emotionally engaged in something. It can be anything. Think about it for yourself. When was the last time you were engaged? It can be a simple matter like, oh, I'm telling my kid, go sit in the car so we can go to school. And actually, for once, he did it without arguing with me. It could be that. Oh, okay, it's innovation. Okay, wait. If I give him this and that, he will go sit quietly every time. Okay, that might be an innovation. But it could be a problem you're working very hard on not doing your work. Like the guy standing in Nima at 2 a.m. in the middle of the night. He was emotionally engaged. And maybe he found out an innovation, I don't know. But you must have engagement. Otherwise you won't succeed. Another thing about innovation, it is a new idea. I took this from Wikipedia, and actually I made a new in very large letters, or a little bit larger letters than the rest, because we use the word innovation today so randomly. People and companies are using it. Oh, you have a new innovation here. It's much faster, much better, much more good looking. It's cheaper, blah, blah, blah. But it's the only enhancement of the previous product. It's a little bit better. But they will like to call it innovation because they know you will buy more then. That's why I call it innovation. For me, innovation is like this. A smartphone. This is an innovation. We got the previous phones, you can call, you can text, and then you got a smartphone from Apple, the iPhone. And the whole industry changed. And we realized, hey, this is connected to the internet. Okay, what can we do now? We have apps, we have too much now, but we have got so much power in this little phone. It's like a little computer. This is an innovation. An innovation isn't another phone back then saving more battery time. That's not an innovation. It could be innovation for how they found out how the battery could be more effective, but it wasn't a new product. And you need to know also about innovation, that innovation is the mother of all change. This is the biggest change you can ever, ever take your hand on. Because innovation is, I will tell you later, but very risky. It costs a lot of money. You don't know if you're going to get anything out of it. This is very big change. And if you have a big change, you must have a vision. Okay, you want to be innovative, you want to do stuff. Okay, but what should we do? What are we aiming for? Is it a new mobile phone? I don't know. Is it a new computer, or throw away the computer? You're hooked up in a chip in your head instead. I don't know. But you need to have a vision about just gathering your organization and people around it. Okay, where are we going? Where are we going? Yeah, you should be innovative. Yeah, okay, tell us where to go. That's where it all starts. And in visions can be very engaging as well. I will show you. Our vision is that all our employees within our organization always should listen to our customers and do their very best to make sure their needs are fulfilled. Our customers fulfill their needs. Okay? Part of a vision. Oh, okay. We like our customers. We want to make them happy. Okay? When we develop new services, we must look at them from the customer's point of view and which particular need this service to fulfill. Okay, customers, okay, we are doing this, new service, okay. Which customer, what's the target group? Who wants it? It's not for us, ourselves, we're doing it, we do it for someone else. We're going to sell it, we're going to make money from it. new services from the customer's point of view. Oh, okay. In the future, he doesn't have a customer support department because the responsibility lies on every employee and everyone should feel obligated to help the customers you interact with. Okay. Wait a minute here. Wait a minute. In the future, no customer support. Well, I get the angry customer. Where's the number? Where should he call? No, we don't have it. He's talking to you. You need to solve it. Been here. It could be something completely different, but can no customer support, really? We must have it. There are a few companies which they don't have a customer support because they believe in this. Okay, this is a vision. Okay, we have no customer support. Okay. Employee should feel they get better in the role and that they always have the possibility to enhance their competence, develop for you to be better. That's how the mostly people's drives are. I'm going to get better at what I do. Getting better in the role, possibility. It's about the words. What are we saying to the people? Everybody should be offered to take part in social activities, both at work but also after working hours. No one should quit the job due to bad possibilities to improve the competence, and so on. Offered social activities, no one should quit, the employees are important. This kind of stuff goes in a vision for me, because it says something. How's our culture? Well, how do we view our employees? Another great vision, I think, for me it's the best vision ever, is the vision in the United States for going to the moon. It was John F. Kennedy in 1962 who said this at Congress. First, I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving a goal before this decade out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth. Before this decade is out, landing a man on the moon. Okay, 62, 8 years. We got 8 years to put the man on the moon in 62. Returning him, we should not only put them there, we should bring him home as well. There are some projects today going on with putting people on Mars and leaving them there. I don't know. No single space project in this time will be more impressive to mankind or more important than long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish. What is he saying? No single space project more impressive or more important. Talk about priority. Hey, I got the project. Yeah, this is the project. We don't care if we have 100 space products. This is the one, top one. If we're going to cut down some products, this is not the one. This is a very powerful statement. And it will not, a number will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish. Okay, we're going to put a lot of money here. And it's going to be like this. It's not going to be, woohoo, you're on the moon. No, no. When we choose to go to the moon, we choose to go to the moon in this decade and do other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. They are hard. This is a very, very tough project to manage and be to make success with. And he said this in 62. And if we rewind in history, what happens in 62? What had happened in the space projects? Yeah, the Russians had a Laika dog around the globe. We had the Gagarin, was up there. And then there was, no, that's it. And suddenly, United States, for some major political reasons, but if you let that aside, decided that we should go to the moon. So I think a lot of people thought he was crazy. How should we do that? It is impossible to go to the moon. We should do something else. We should send a guy around the globe. But if I had been there in 62, I had raised my, do you want to take part? I have raised my hand instantly. If I actually designed a little bolt that sat on the spaceship that took them to the moon. I said, I was a part of setting a man on the moon. That's enough for me. Okay, I made money, but I put it, I brought that bolt, the engine had collapsed. I don't know. But I think a lot of people was thinking about him as mad. I think it's like today, we should have it March in 5 years. It would be 10 million people living in March. It could be the same crazy idea, I don't know. But the key is here that innovation is created by people who strive to fulfill the same vision and goals. You must gather the people around something, like the United States did when they have this vision. They gathered the whole nation around this, we shall go to the moon. With a vision, which was the fuel for engagement and empowering people, and I want to take part, or you're crazy, I want to take part, but most people took part. So, what was the first question he got from the email? How should he report that time? No one has granted him some extra pay for staying up and work so late. And how many hours did he actually work? We are not paying that. You need to have permission from your boss and your bosses and so on. That was the first question he got from the stakeholder who had put money on a project that, he wanted something to happen. And the first question, how do we report the time? Who gives? He fixed a solution for a huge problem. Okay, 10, I'll give him 10 extra hours of time. I don't care, it cost us this little. And he helped a project that might otherwise have been cut down. It cost us millions of money. It's just a mindset. Okay, what are you talking to people about? What are you saying to them? What is important? What kind of message are we sending to the people in our organization when we are communicating with them? What is important? Solution problems or report the time correctly? I don't know. There was another survey in 2011, how change was communicated by companies. And interviewed a lot of people once more. And there were, I don't know if you took part, but Sweden was there. And it was a sad number again, and about 18% of the people in the organization felt that the communication going on within the organization was good. 82% of them thought it was bad. And then you have a change, a huge change like innovation, and only 80% of the people you're communicating out this fantastic vision of change or actually think this, this is good communication. I understand what you're saying. I feel engaged. And one reason why they felt that when they tried to be innovative and they were only 18%, that was because in the usual communication, in the ordinary projects, they were bad as well. That was it was even worse when they were actually communicating about innovation. They were so bad to start with to communicate. So that's, you can't win them. So you have the vision, you want to go to the moon maybe. Okay, so what do we need to change to get there? What should we do? Jesus, spacecraft, you need everything. You need to start thinking about this. But when you present the change message, the message you want to come in, you must show real and authentic commitment. As I'm trying to do now for you. Because if you have leaders, you have CEOs talking a lot to the people, the bosses within the companies, talking to their employees, and they are not engaged, and they are not believing what they're saying, how should we even think about how do we think the people will feel, actually listen to it, if the manager talking isn't engaged about it. I can give you an example. Often, they have a lot of text, quite small, and they come in, and they stand like this at the podium, and they say, oh, in our latest reports and statistics, we have come to realize that our share market only gives us place number five compared with our competitors. If the trend continues, we won't be in the top 20 within a couple of years. Not long ago, we were number one. Okay. Sorry. Have I misplaced? I'm just in the volume, sorry. So let's feedback this. Okay, what did he say? He said something about statistics, only place 5, the top 20, not long ago, number 1. Okay, what's. Yeah, okay. We continue. Yeah. Therefore, we will launch a new program to monitor and implement more control functions to understand why our customer. And now it happens. Dinner tomorrow, meeting Fred. Now you're checking out. He keeps on talking, you're like, yeah, it's the ordinary stuff. They're usual, blah, 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 blah. I don't care. Because what are they saying? Okay, new program on controller, top manager. Oh, okay, what's for dinner? I must take an important message and disappear and come back after the meeting has closed, because then I skip out and I don't have to sit there. I can actually do some work maybe at my workplace. So it continues. We must also analyze why our competence isn't enough. Okay, analyze. Lack of competence. Mandatory training. We must go on a team building. Must go on a team building. Seriously, you must go and team build. Okay. Oh, it's fun. No, you must go. It could be fun, but you must go. More info somebody. And that, this is actually the super classic. Okay, so you come into a lot of people like you. You take this statement, you read it. You have never heard it before. It's totally new. And then in the last sentence, you say, more info some other time. Okay. So he goes away, and you sit there, and you look at your nearest boss or something. What did he say? I don't know. I just heard it as you heard it. I have not been briefed before. Okay. So then it's more info. I don't know. Okay. So everybody was back at the workplace. Okay, next try to work. But what did he say? And you start thinking about what he actually said. Okay, team thing, when happens that, blah, blah, blah. You start thinking about that instead of thinking about, okay, let's get down to work again. So you leave your people, the audience, hanging there for, oh, we want more info. Yeah, we will have it some other time. Okay, why not now? No, some other time. Because when you tell stuff to people, which is new for them, you can hear, he surely sat there at this desk and put this together for like 10 hours. For him, it isn't new anymore, but for you, it is new. For you to hear it, you need to have your brain, yeah, okay, what did it say? Process it for a while. So for the next meeting, you have to come back, okay, now I have some questions. Because that's another classic. They talk a lot, and then, yeah, any questions? But, I haven't even heard what they said. What kind of question? I might need to process this in my brain. So I maybe come back to you later and have this question. This is the wrong way, but have any of you ever heard some similar message like this anytime in your work, at your work? Ah, you lucky guys. It's just terrible because because the people actually saying this actually believes that they are doing a great job. When they are not, they are doing a terrible job. So how should you do it? You could do it something like this. If you don't react now and make some drastic changes, we will no longer be at the top 5 position compared to our competitors. A few years ago, we lost the number one position, and if the trend continues, we will not be at the top 20 in a few years. Okay, what did we say? We're saying something about dramatic changes. Woo, okay, not top 5. Good. Not top 20. Okay. Smartphone, anyone? No? Well, maybe I will hear a little bit more before I decide to put up my smartphone. The time is short to take proper action, but we need to do it now. If we act fast, we can make some big changes. We can make the trend shift and make us number one again. Okay? Time is short. We're in a hurry. We must act now. We are fast. We have big changes. We will be number one again. No? Okay? Maybe not smartphone. We have realized we need to have customer focus with our entire organization. No matter what title or description you got, we must all act from a customer point of view when we're working and changing the way we work. Customer focus, title doesn't matter. I'm the CEO, we don't care. Treat the customers. I work at the warehouse, we don't care. I have the customer focus. Oh, it's hard, a lot of boxes. Yeah, man. Move them faster, I don't know. Furthermore, we shall develop and educate and increase our social activities among our employees because they are our most important asset. We are going to succeed. Okay, who is important? The employees. We should educate them. We should increase the social activities. We must not go to a team building. Maybe we should because it's fun or... it's a good activity to do to bond with each other, I don't know. In 3 years, we'll be back on the number one position again, and we will make it happen thanks to our employees and customers. 3 years, okay, then three years, we're number one. And who will do it? Yeah, the employees and the customer. Focus, you guys, if you were hired by me, and the customers out there. They're the most important asset. Not some sort of manager group taking another, doing another strategy. Because innovation is created by people who listens to message which speaks to their feelings in here. And it's communicated by engaged speakers which believes in the message they are sending. Like the vision for the United States. We want to go to the moon. Okay, well, no matter what kind of emotion you get about that, but you get an emotion. Great, bad. You have an emotion. I will take another example of usually how big hierarchical organizations do when they try to be more innovative. The usual way. They have a lot of people in their organizations, and most of the time they know, okay, he's good, he's an expert, she's good, take them all together, all the experts in our organization with a great competence, with all the best skills, and they will go on a trip just exploring the surroundings and eating good food and come up with great innovations. And then come back on Monday and we have a list and let's do it. Okay? Let's do it. Let's send them away. We want a list from you, all the best in our company. Go away and come back with a list of innovations. Okay? And that can sound a little bit harsh, but then again, good food, drinks and so on. Yeah, I can go with that. I'm an expert. Yeah, that's good too. I will follow now. But when they come back on Monday, to this kind of organization, and we leave the proposal, and usually we can cut out like 80% of the suggestions because they are only improvements of the existing processes or products. We can cut them away, and maybe have a core of 20% of the list is actually innovations, like we shall not have a customer support department, we shall build a smartphone, we shall not build our usual phones anymore. But then they get some kind of lukewarm response from the managers there. Because then this happens. Yeah, that's great, you were good, but we cannot change, we cannot have a customer, should we fire people? And I'm the boss from the customer support, I won't have my job back, I will not tolerate this, and they will die. And one of the reasons for that is, you must think about what goals does this organization have. You have this organization which is excellent at doing what we're doing today. We have trimmed it, we have applied lean and so on. We have our processes are perfect, it's effective and so on. We don't want an innovation, we don't want anything new, because that disrupts our goals, because I am measured from the way I perform according to budget and for my boss above me, and his boss and so on. That's the reward. Sit still in the boat, do your stuff the best you can, save us money, make us money, and you will be promoted higher up in the ranks. That's why it's so hard to come with a list of innovations from the experts and just put them on the table. Here, we want to do this. It doesn't work. It could work if it comes from the top and down, but then again. And the company also starts to think about, maybe we didn't have the right experts. Maybe our competence was too bad. Maybe there was the wrong place to go. Maybe we should send them 2 weeks to Miami instead. Maybe we should hire another consulting firm, 10 strategy experts, and send them away, bringing back ideas. I'm talking against myself not because I'm a consultant, but then again. And they bring in the strategy experts and come out with a fully loaded document for 80 pages that no one will ever read, except the one who wrote it. And then they have, okay, innovations, here we go. Read the document. No, it doesn't work. And most of all, when you think about why they're not accepting the new ideas as much as they should do, is courage. To actually do something that we don't know that will bring back money to us. What's the ROE? Okay, we put in this money and we get back this money. Okay, fine. And we have a mining factory. No, innovation. You got an innovation. Sorry, doesn't work. Money in the lake. Innovation number 2, same effect. Innovation number 10, like Rovio, out 62, I thought it was 63. Success, you make up for all the other innovations you did that wasn't really good, all the prototypes. No, it's perfect. No, it's an innovation. Now you make all the money, but you need to have courage to do that. Without courage, within organization and within persons, you will never have it. You think, look, small startups, they have a lot of courage, usually limited to funds, but they just, I got a great idea, let's do it. I put some friends around and they do, just do it. And maybe they will be bankrupt in six months. They don't care. Maybe they will invent a new Google. Maybe they will. But you need to have, if you're thinking about, we want to be innovated, yeah, start with pulling up some courage, because you will need it. Because innovation is higher risk. There is no, the highest risk, I think. All, today is all about risk management, how should we handle the risk as well. For innovation, hey, you can't get much higher than that. You will never know if it will be successful or not. It is an investment, it's not a cost. It's not another product that costs money. It's an investment in something that we believe in, that maybe will pay off in the end or not. But it is investment, it's not a cost. And innovation is, it's a huge change, it is. But you get higher rewards when you are successful. It is okay to fail. That's also the mindset you must have when you're doing innovation. It is okay to fail, because you will do it a lot of times. And it is a challenge, but it could be a great fun challenge to do it. So, innovation is created by people that is brave and dare to invest in something new and different. Let's talk about a little about Agile as well, because I think it's a great way of working. Agile, it's top notch. But we're usually very good at being Agile our projects. We're Agile, we have Agile projects. We're doing Scrum, we're doing Kanban, or this, we are doing some kind of method for being Agile. But the rest of the organization is the same. They are not Agile, they are just doing the ordinary business. And at the bottom, you are very Agile. And as a company, you must realize when we want to be Agile. Okay, Agile is a mindset up here. Agile is not a method. Scrum is a method based on Agile's mindset. So if you are doing projects that are Agile, you need to adjust your organization and think about, okay, they're Agile. How could we be Agile as well? But because otherwise, you will be Agile at the bottom, but you're not real Agile. And once again, it's all about communicating. What are you saying to your Agile teams? What are the most important questions you ask your product? How's the budget? No, that's not the question. Okay. How high risk do you have? No. What are you delivering? How does it go? We want this. We want a box. How far have you come? Oh, here's a prototype. It looks like this and this and this. Okay. We have put in a lot of money maybe for manufacturing it, but the stakeholders can look for themselves in all the kind of systems. They don't need to ask the product manager that question. Focus on the result. What are we doing? What are we getting out of all this? We're putting a lot of energy and people in this, and focus on what are we getting out. Because this is one of the principles connected to the manifesto. Our highest priority is to satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of valuable software, like you have sprints or something. But most of the time, you do sprints. You can have 10 sprints, 20 sprints. It doesn't matter. But in the end of the sprint, you deliver something to maybe a test environment, maybe not. And then we test it. Oh, it's okay, it's good, okay. Okay, that part is done. Okay, let's do it another part. We're now working on other parts. Why don't release it if you can? They have done a little part. They have made this service. You can work for yourself. Ship it. Why wait? Yeah, we wait and bundle up a lot of everything from the results from the sprints. And then we have one huge delivery which has high risk of failing. Maybe, I'm not saying that every time you have something that you actually can release, but if you have it, release it, why wait? Business people and developers must work together daily throughout the project. Well, okay, sounds good. But then again, I don't have time. I'm ordered this project, but I don't have time. I have to report to my boss. Why do we need to engage? I have talked to you and have put it down in a document. Can you read the documentation and just make it happen? Okay, but I'm working for you. I'm working as something you want, not for me. Why shouldn't? And that's because we are putting in so much time in our organizations for people to attend so many meetings that are completely useless in the end. But it will take up time for the actual work to be done. So they cannot engage in this. They should, because they order it. but they don't. Build products around motivated individuals, give them the environmental support they need, and trust them to get the job done. Okay? Trust them. Okay, I want the budget, stage reporting, I want the forecast, I want the best practice, I want the plan. That's a lot about trust there. I want the estimate. Yeah, it's good, but the estimate. Okay, you have it like this, okay, you get the budget. Okay, that's good. Then it can throw it away. But this are the stuff you're telling the people, and we trust them being agile. And we say this. Because we chose to go to the moon, we chose to go to the moon in this decade and do other things, not because they are easy, because they are hard. We actually did it. Maybe some conspiracy theory doesn't believe that, but I believe they went to the moon. But they actually made it happen to put the man up there. Not in eight, I think it was 72, they missed with 2 years or something like that. They thought this decade is out, it was only 8 years, but they did it. They actually did it. Because in the end, it is once more about communicating and what words are we saying to the people in our organization. Effective. I have heard effective so many times at my work, so I stop listening when someone says effective. Who wants to go to work to be ineffective? I don't know. Yeah, maybe they're not engaged backdoor people, maybe, but the others. You should be effective. Woo! Let's get out of bed for that. I want to be effective today. But even when we are saying that to the people, and we want control, and we say, put up a lot of meetings, and now we have control, we have every numbers in our system, we can now monitor them every minute, we have the time reporting down at minutes. We can have GPS sensors in the back in the skull, so we can monitor where they go, I don't know. Because, in the end, we are people. And we need to understand that we are people, but we are beginning to forget that. We treat our people in our organizations like robots. I tell them effective stuff instead of saying we want to have words like engagement possibilities and so on, and energy. Thank you.
Christian Elffors, ladies and gentlemen, once again. I know it's lunchtime, but I believe we can have like 5 minutes for questions and answering session, right? So at least a couple of questions. I have like dozen.
Okay, but at the end of the day, we have to feed 600 heads and we cannot do it by garage projects, and we need big projects which ask for us CMMIs and so on. What to tell to them?
Yeah, I'm not saying, hopefully I understand the question. I'm not saying that we should have budget or we shouldn't have status reporting and so on. We should have all that stuff if we want it. That's okay. But you don't need to tell the people that, oh, maybe the product manager, but the product manager doesn't have to put up the product plan each time he meets the team. He can share it for his stakeholder, but often for himself. But then again, the team, the developer, probably doesn't care about the product plan. He wants the program. So why don't we tell him to, yeah. So, yeah, use it, but think about what you're saying. Okay?
Okay. What is your great innovation? What is your best innovation? Your best innovation. Do you have one?
Best innovation for me.
Exactly.
Which I have made?
Yes.
I I'm quite actually quite bad at picking up innovations. I'm much better with people that has ideas, innovations. I'm a product manager most of the time, but to pick up people which actually have ideas, to engage them, and okay, you have a fantastic idea, let's go into a room, a whiteboard, and so on. That's my key role, I think. I'm not so innovative myself. I think I have been a product manager for like 8 years, 9 years now, and I realized this one year ago, that I have been on endless, calling people to endless meetings, saying stuff, and I realized, what have I been said to them? I should be saying something completely different to them. That was my biggest, I think, for innovation for myself, to realize that you can throw away 8 years of product management, leadership skills, and but okay, let's do this once more, one more time.